Penguin Random House Audio presents Fake Accounts by Lauren Oyler, read for you by Rebecca Lowman. Beginning. Consensus was the world was ending, or would begin to end soon, if not by exponential environmental catastrophe, then by some combination of nuclear war, the American two-party system, patriarchy, white supremacy, gentrification, globalization, data breaches, and social media. People looked sad, on the subway, in the bars. Decisions were questioned, opinions rearranged. The same grave epiphany was dragged around everywhere. We were transitioning from an only retrospectively easy past to an inarguably more difficult future. We were, it could no longer be denied, unstoppably bad. Although the death of any hope for humanity was surely decades in the making, the result of many intersecting systems described forbiddingly well, it was only that short period between the election of a new president and his holding up a hand to swear to serve the people's interests that made clear what had happened, that we were too late. I didn't believe all this necessarily, though as the news got worse and more bizarre, I wavered. I've always been drawn to pragmatism, just not exactly a natural at it. As my brain says, calm down. My heart says, also weirdly calmly, a paradoxical comfort can be found in drama. It was, and still is, my official position, if you were to ask me at a party or something, that the popular turn to fatalism could be attributed to self-aggrandizement and an ignorance of history, history being characterized by the population's quickness to declare apocalypse finally imminent despite its permanently delayed arrival. We don't want to die. But we also don't want to do anything challenging, such as what living requires, so the volubility with which certain doom was discussed made a tedious kind of sense. The end of the world would let us have our cake and eat it too. We would have no choice but to die, our potential conveniently unrealizable due to our collapse. Until such time, the idea that everything was totally pointless now was seductive, particularly as a mantra you could take advantage of when it suited you and abandon when life actually started to feel alarming. I myself was soon using it to indulge some of my naughtier impulses, by which I mean that in the first hours of a morning in early January, when the sky was still dark and the government still inevitably hurtling, I decided to snoop through my boyfriend's phone while he was asleep. I'd never really had the urge to go through another person's things before. After a few disappointing experiences with high school boyfriends' instant message histories, I'd learned that poking around the byproducts of other people's thoughts usually yielded the mundane, the predictable, and the unattractive. Even with men I respected intellectually, I never found myself caring enough to breach their trust. Before Felix, my boyfriends exuded the wholesome, loving, deep-down reliability of hot dads on television shows, despite being, as far as I knew, not hot, nor dads, nor on television. Another way of putting this is that before Felix, I had good taste. With the exception of a water polo player I once showered with in college, a handful of celebrities, and anyone else I may find myself dazzled by in the future, I avoid obvious physical attractiveness because I believe it presages suffering. But over the year and a half we'd been together, Felix had revealed himself to be completely unrevealing, insisting over and over as I baited and nagged and implored him to tell me his innermost hopes, fears, and childhood-formed biases, either that there was nothing to tell, or, conflictingly, that he'd told me everything already, and it wasn't his fault if I didn't remember. It was humiliating and typical, and per the usual narrative, I assumed he was hiding something, probably other women. He almost always slept with his cell phone under his pillow. At first, I'd thought this was just an arbitrary thing he did, or that it was related to some concern about emergencies transpiring in the night or a previous lack of side table. But after he started acting different, not strange, but different, I became certain he did it because he feared I would read his emails and text messages. That his bedtime cell phone habit predated his change in behavior from funny, somewhat reserved guy to slightly less funny, somewhat more reserved guy didn't matter. Regardless of motive, it was weird to sleep with your phone under your pillow. And I'd failed to think about that until his subtle shift in comportment had me examining everything he did in a new light. There wasn't much to go on, but that didn't matter either. Sometimes lately when we were texting each other, little ellipses would appear in the chat to indicate Felix was typing to me for an extended period of time, perhaps an entire minute. But then the message would never arrive. He'd have typed whatever it was and deleted it, and instead of sending something less delicate or elaborate in its place, he would just stop texting me as if we were fighting. This seems like a relatively small thing until it happens to you 12 or 13 times. His password, numerical, was long, and as far as I could tell, random, and I was only able to figure it out after weeks of surreptitiously watching him tap it out whenever I could, acquiring new numbers out of sequence one by one. He frequently bragged about not being addicted to his phone, so this took longer than it might have otherwise, especially because we didn't see each other as often as I understood other couples of our status to see each other, about once a week, when it should have been at least twice. I was resentful about this. My sense that I was being wronged was more powerful than my growing ambivalence about the relationship, which was surely related to the distance between us he'd created, but not entirely. So part of it, the snooping, was also about revenge. I briefly considered trying to place his thumb on the circular recessed fingerprint sensor, which is, as I write this, already becoming obsolete, replaced by facial recognition, which is of course even worse, while he was asleep. But I'm not a reckless person. My risks are calculated, and my dishonesty is dignified. I'd had a few other opportunities to act before. When he went to the store to buy beer and forgot his phone on the table, when he was in the shower on one of the rare occasions he stayed long enough to want to bathe at my apartment. His phone was always pulling at me, like my own phone did, but in a more sinister way. He was private, but never thorough, a manner that I guess might have convinced me he wasn't hiding anything if I hadn't been so sure he was. Instead, I considered these lapses either evidence of his incompetence or, more likely, a misdirection strategy. But until that night, I'd been hesitant to pick up the phone and confirm my suspicions. Part of it was that I tried to avoid, as much out of elementary school habit as out of genuine belief in the importance of collective reciprocity, doing things to others that I wouldn't want done to me. A bigger part of it was that I dreaded getting caught. A tense confrontation in which I'd have to pretend to feel remorse and ask for forgiveness I didn't really have any use for, the relationship being in my mind already basically over, which is almost certainly what I'd do. I'm not given to screaming fights, especially those that require me to dig in and defend my own questionable honor. I can never come up with any memorable insults, and I tend to come out looking like a shamed child instead of a passionate and self-possessed woman. The righteousness Felix could wield over me if it turned out he wasn't sleeping with other women, the vindication I'd need for my sneaky actions, was also discouraging. It would hasten the inevitable breakup, which would be a relief, but I would seem totally pathetic. Serendipity arrived on the wings of the gray goose. Felix and I had gotten moderately drunk at a bar down the street from my apartment, and he came over afterward. I'm tired, I'm very, very tired, he sang on the way home. I'm not even going to brush my teeth. Such goofiness was uncharacteristic. It put me on edge. When I'd nod my head along with the music in a cafe or put on some minor performance of impromptu joy, He'd often look distraught, or even ask me, glancing around, as if truly uncomfortable, to stop. He did brush his teeth in the end, and then proceeded to my bedroom, humming the I'm Tired song.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.